In this video, I'm going to be going through a series of lab experiments to use the Teensy to demonstrate how PWM works and how changing the PWM resolution and frequency affects the output. Then we're going to generate a sine wave using both the Teensy, PWM, and then use a low-pass filter so we can filter or demodulate the PWM and see the actual sine wave coming out.
As I mentioned, we're going to be going through some experiments to demonstrate how PWM works on the Teensy. So we have the list here from the course site, and we're going to start off by running the blink demo on the Teensy. And this is our basically go-to test, because if demo blink doesn't work, then we have some sort of communication issue between the Teensy and the computer because we're using onboard hardware. The first thing we need to do is launch the Arduino application. By default, it'll tell you it's creating a new sketchbook. We needed to go Tools, Board, and select Teensy 3.2, 3.1. This assumes that you've installed the Teensy Arduino software on top of Arduino. And then we go File, Examples, Basics, Blink. Now we need to hook up our Teensy.
To hook the Teensy up, we take the micro USB cable and plug it into the Teensy, and then wait for it to get set up on the computer.
What we can see in the demo blink program is that we're using LED 13, which is the built-in LED on the Teensy 3.1, 3.2. We're going to set it to high, then low, then high, then low. So now we're going to click upload. At this point, it's busy compiling the data to be able to upload it to the Teensy, creating the hex file that gets uploaded.
Once it finishes uploading, we should see that the light starts blinking on the Teensy. This tells us that we're able to compile our software and upload it, and we don't have to worry about any other issues. So at any point, if you're trying to debug your Teensy and figure out if it's your circuit or it's the software, a good check is to see if blink works.
Now that we've shown that we can actually talk to the Teensy from our computer by compiling and uploading a sketch, we're now going to look at how analogWrite and PWM works. And we're going to be using the fade program. We can find that from File, Examples, Basics, Fade. So I'm going to close out of blink, and I'm going to go and open up the fade program. And we can see that the fade program has an LED pin 9, a brightness amount, and a fade amount. And so we just set that pin 9 as an output, and then we go through, and every time we go through the loop, we output a PWM value called brightness, and then we change the brightness value by the fade amount, which is 5. And then if we hit the maximum or minimum, we're going to end up reversing our direction. Let's see what this looks like.
Now we're going to wire up our Teensy to an oscilloscope so we can actually see what the PWM signals look like. The first pin on the Teensy is the ground, so we're going to connect that to our oscilloscope ground, and we're going to be using the fade program, which uses analogWrite on pin 9 to do the output. So we can count, the pin next to ground is 0, so we go 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I'm also going to wire in an LED to help us see the fade program and what's going on in real life. So on an LED, we have two different leads. One's longer than the other, and it's a little hard to tell there, so I'll hold up in front of the screen. And it's always difficult sometimes to remember which one's which. So the way I remember it is the longer lead is called the anode, which sounds like additional. And additional is a plus sign, so that's the plus side. So therefore, we're going to put our positive voltage into the longer lead, our anode, and our negative voltage, or our ground, to the cathode. So we're going to connect our anode, and we're going to put a resistor here that's going to connect pin 9 to our LED. So we're going to go through a resistor. It's a 470 ohm resistor, which just limits the amount of current going through. So you have a current limiting resistor, and the last thing we need to do is connect our ground from the Teensy to the ground bus. And on some of these breadboards, something you need to remember is that this side and this side might not necessarily be connected, so it's important to sometimes connect these two grounds. The last thing we need to do is now upload our code to the Teensy. We can first see that the LED goes from full brightness down to zero brightness back to full brightness. But we see that the oscilloscope looks to be freaking out. So that's because we need to adjust our time per divide. And I'm going to increase the volts per divide to make it a little easier for us to see. And let's go one more notch. Well, if you remember, I said that the fundamental frequency of PWM on the Arduino is 490 hertz approximately. It's 488. And we could see that is the frequency of the signal here. And we could also look at our volts per divide and see that we have 2 milliseconds per divide. And if you look at it, that's about 500 hertz. So that makes sense. But we could see here that the ratio of on to off is going from completely off to completely on. And that's timed with our LED's brightness. So we can kind of see how the PWM essentially fades, or the duty cycle changes, and also the LED's brightness. Right now, our oscilloscope is set into AC-DC coupling mode. If I change it to AC coupling, it means we're going to subtract out the DC component. Watch this. We'll notice that it goes up and down. And what's going on there, and I'm going to make sure that we're centered at zero here, is that we're essentially trying to keep the average at zero as we're going up and down. I'm going to return our oscilloscope back to DC coupling mode. And I'm now going to separate it out a little bit. I'm now going to attach a multimeter, where an oscilloscope is designed to show us changes in voltage with respect to time. Our multimeter is designed to essentially show us the average voltage, the DC voltage. Now, there are fancier settings, but for all intents and purposes, it's going to show us the average. Just like the LED isn't flickering as fast as our oscilloscope signal, we're going to see the same reading on our multimeter. So I'm going to attach the ground of the multimeter to the ground signal of the Teensy. I'm going to attach the positive lead to the positive here. It's a little hard to tell what's going on. We can see it's moving very quickly. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into the Teensy code, and I'm going to slow down how fast we move through. So I'm going to increase our delay from 30 milliseconds to 150 milliseconds between each step. And what we see now is that it takes a lot more time for it to go from fully on to fully off. But we could see the DC voltage is going from zero up to a maximum value of 1.8 and back down. Now, why is that? Let's now move our clip over to this side. Now we're going from 0 to 3.3 back. Well, remember that voltage drops for a series circuit, we're going to have a drop across each element. And so that's basically accounting for the voltage drop across that resistor. So if we want to see the 0 to the full 3.3 output of the Teensy, we need to make sure we take the voltage measurement from the Teensy side, not the other end of the resistor. But we can see here how if I were to stop the signal, let's say we were at half, well, the oscilloscope, or the multimeter, also reads the same. So the multimeter is displaying, basically, the ratio of on to off, or our duty cycle, times 3.3, which is our maximum output of the Teensy. And that's how PWM works, is that these lower frequency devices, be it an LED, a motor, or a multimeter, see the average voltage. But if we zoom in, we can see clear on the oscilloscope how we're ending up with that PWM signal. So the carrier is at 488 hertz, and we're changing the duty cycle.
The next experiment we're going to do is we're going to add the command analogWrite frequency 9,50,000 to our code. So that goes into the void setup mode. Now let's see what that does. I'm going to upload it to the Teensy.
Well, if I look at my LED, I look at my multimeter, it essentially seems to be doing the same thing. But my screen on my oscilloscope is freaking out. Well, let's now zoom in. So we're going to change our volts per divide. And what we can see is we still have that we're going from 100% duty cycle back down to 0% duty cycle, back up to 100% duty cycle, and it's taking the same amount of time to do that as before we put that command in. But what's changed is our carrier frequency. Now our carrier frequency is at 50,000 hertz or 50 kilohertz rather than the 488 that it was by default. So why would you do this? Well, an advantage is, I don't know if you've ever heard some hums in machines. Well, human hearing goes up to about 20 kilohertz as the maximum range. So right now, we're flickering past where we can hear it. So sometimes when you hear a device, it means that they're switching it at a frequency that's within the human hearing range. Well, it just so happens that the Arduino's 488 hertz as the default is pretty close to a D. So that's why if we use the Arduino there, sometimes we might hear it if we're using a relay or something else that's able to oscillate and produce vibrations. So that's one of the reasons why we might want to change the frequency, and we'll see another reason later on.
For this next experiment, we're going to add the command analogWrite resolution 12 to the void setup here. And I'm going to lessen our delay here just to make things a little easier to see. So we're going to put this at 50 milliseconds, and we're going to re-upload that to the Teensy.
Let's look at what we have now. We can see that our duty cycle is increasing and decreasing like before, except for now we're not going from 0 to 100%. We're only going from 0 to a slight percentage. And if we look, the LED is only getting slightly bright, then dimming again. We can also see this phenomena on the multimeter. What's happening right now? Why is this? Well, let's look at the code.
The analogWrite frequency command changed the PWM frequency of pin 9 to 50 kHz. We just used the analogWrite resolution command. Now we changed it to 12. By default, the analogWrite resolution of an Arduino or a Teensy is 8 bits, and if we do 2 to the 8th, we get 256 different values. But wait, we just changed it now to 12-bit. So 2 to the 12 is 4,096 values. Let's look at our code. We have a variable brightness. Every time we go around, brightness is equal to brightness plus fade amount, which is 5. If brightness is less than or equal to 0 or greater than or equal to 255, change the direction. Well, 255 out of 255 is full brightness in 8-bit mode. But what's 255 out of 4,096? Well, we could do that real fast. If we launch our calculator, we said that we have 255 divided by 4,095 times 3.3 is our maximum output. So we're only going up to 0.2 volts instead of 3.3 volts.
And we can see that over here is that we get close to 2.2 volts, and if we go into max min, that might make it easier. We could see that we're getting only up to about 0.2 volts, and we could see 0.205 is our theoretical maximum. So then what do we need to do?
Well, if we come back over to the code here, now why don't we set it so that we need to go to a maximum of 4,095, not 255, and let's see if that changes it.
I just re-uploaded the code, and I'm going to turn off max min. That way we go back. And we can see it's moving slowly. So it's not going as quickly as it did through the range of values. But now we're going to go from 0 all the way up to the full 3.3. We've increased our resolution, which means we increased the number of steps or the number of possible duty cycles between 0% and 100% from 256 different ratios to 4,096 different ratios. That gives us a lot more control. So if I wanted to speed this up, I'd either have to lessen the delay, or in the code, I'd also be able to go and change my fade amount. So if I decreased my delay, I'd go through faster, or if instead I can now go by, let's say, 50 increments, and we'll see that we go and we can increase our speed there. Now we are still going from zero to full, but it's going much quicker. So that's what resolution does. So we changed our frequency, and then we changed our resolution. So far as the LED and the multimeter are concerned, the frequency didn't matter. But the resolution did, and we had to make sure that we had our code set correctly to take advantage of the extra values in 12-bit resolution.
Our final experiment today is going to be recreating the homework assignment, where we wanted to plot a 2-volt peak-to-peak sine wave with a 1.5-volt DC bias That's a 1 kilohertz signal. We also created that using the signal generator in the oscilloscope. Now we're going to use the Teensy to create that same signal. And to do that, we need to set up a low pass filter. And so I've uploaded the PDF circuit for you to build. We can see that we have an 8.2 kiloohm resistor and a 0.01 microfarad capacitor. The frequency of a low pass filter is determined by 1 over 2 pi, the resistance times the capacitance. So we have 1 divided by the quantity 2 times pi times 8.2 times 1,000 times 0.01 times 1 divided by 1 million. Gives us a cutoff frequency of 2,000 hertz. That means our low pass filter is not going to allow through any signals at a frequency higher than 2,000 hertz. It's going to cut those off. And that's okay because we're trying to create a 1 kilohertz sine wave. And what we're going to be doing here is demodulating our PWM signal. That's why we increased the analogWrite frequency to such a high value so that when we filter it out, we're going to be left with our sine wave. I'm going to show you what this looks like in a second.
I'm going to build the low pass filter circuit. So I'm going to remove the LED and its resistor. And I'm now going to put in that 8.2 kiloohm resistor. And I'm then going to also add my 0.1 microfarad capacitor. I need to connect that capacitor to ground. So I'm going to take this jumper lead here and go from the capacitor down to ground. And so we now have pin 9 going across the resistor, then across the capacitor to ground. The first place we're going to look at our signal is we're going to connect to the point where the resistor and the capacitor come together. So I'm going to grab that with my oscilloscope lead.
Okay, let's take a look at the code for the challenge.
If we think back to how we did this in MATLAB, we essentially created a time array and then evaluated what the signal was at any given time using the equation of a sine wave, amplitude times sine of omega t plus the DC offset. Well, what we're going to do now is we're going to have the Teensy run in essentially real-time mode and compute at any given time what voltage or what PWM value it should be outputting. So this is essentially going to actually create a continuous output. So we have to break this apart into different things. We're going to start with the concept of the amplitude. So we need to determine what PWM value is the amplitude. We said we have a 2-volt peak-to-peak. So 2 volts over 3.3 max times our max PWM of 4,095 gives us 2,481, and we divide that by 2. And we can see here that we're going to multiply our sine times 2,481 over 2. You'll notice for all of these I put a period after the numbers. That's very important because that tells the Teensy to do floating point math instead of treating it like integers. So our amplitude is going to be that PWM value. Our DC offset is 1.5 volts, so we do 1.5 over 3.3 times 4,095, gives us 1861. Inside the sine, though, is where things get a little interesting. So we need omega t. Well, omega is 2 pi times the frequency, so that'd be 2 times pi times 1,000 hertz. But omega t, how do we get the t? How do we figure out what time it is? Well, we're going to be using the micros command. And the micros command returns the number of microseconds since we started the microcontroller up. Basically, it'll tell us where we should be along the sine wave, and that clock runs essentially continuously. So what we're going to need to do is omega times t. So we said omega is 2 pi times 1,000 times your time in seconds. Well, micros returns the time in microseconds. So we need to divide that by a million, which essentially means that if we multiply all this out and simplify, we're going to do pi times micros over 500. Basically, what we're now computing is the instantaneous PWM value at any given time for that continuous sine wave signal. And that's equal to the sine of omega t times our amplitude plus our DC offset. And that every time we go around the loop, we're going to figure out what time it is, and then given that time, compute what the PWM value is, and then we're going to write it. We use this int, which basically converts the floating point or the decimal math into a solid number between zero, an integer number between 0 and 4095, which we can then output using PWM. Let's see what that looks like. Well, initially when I boot up and I haven't adjusted the oscilloscope from our earlier experiments, I see this wave freaking out. Now remember, we're taking our signal measurement from after the resistor. Let's see what it looks like before the resistor, and I'm going to clamp that on. There's our pretty familiar PWM, right? 50 kilohertz, and we can see that it's moving really quickly. But let's go back to this side. All of a sudden, I see these smoothed out waves, but I don't see that PWM. And that's because we're filtering it out. Now, let's change our volts per divide. We can see that we have that beautiful 1 kilohertz sine wave that we programmed in. And yes, we have little fluctuations up and down. That's the PWM signal. Now, we filtered out or demodulated our output pretty well through this low pass filter, but we can still see the slight fluctuations. We can also see that we have our baseline set to zero, and 1.5 volts is the DC offset. So to reiterate, our Arduino code is computing what we should be outputting, our duty cycle, continuously, and it's updating that every single time we go around, thousands and thousands of times a second. The Teensy runs right now at 96 megahertz. So 96 million times that we're going around. Now it's slowed down with overhead from all the programs running in the background and stuff, but still, we're running at a very high frequency. So we're easily updating thousands and thousands of times a second. And our PWM's running at 50 kilohertz. So essentially, we can assume that about 50,000 times a second, we are updating that duty cycle or plotting a new point along here. Then we come over to our low pass filter. And our low pass filter is essentially saying, get rid of the PWM and just keep the average value. And that average is essentially what that sine omega t is times A plus DC. And when we look at it after the filter, we see this nice signal. And if I were to look before the filter, you can still see how we have that PWM. And then when we filter it out, we're left with our nice 1 kilohertz sine wave. So we've seen the continuation from creating this sine wave using a signal generator and then plotting it in MATLAB and pseudo-continuously plotting those points. And now we've used the Teensy as essentially a real-time signal generator to create our sine wave. I hope that you found this video helpful and that you could apply these principles to your own work. For more information, please check out my website, mattbilski.com, and consider subscribing to the channel for more updates on tutorials like this and other mechatronics topics. Thanks, and hope to hear from you soon.